Thank you. death of the cross, and by his glorious resurrection delivered us from the power of our enemy. Grant us so to die daily to sin, that we may evermore live with him in the joy of his resurrection. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated for greeting.
A reading from the book of Acts. Peter began to speak to Cornelius and the other Gentiles. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee, after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed him, Jesus of Nazareth, with the Holy Spirit and with power, and how they went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with them. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him. And after he rose from the dead, he commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll say the gradual together, Psalm 118, responsibly by half. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
His mercy endures forever.
Let Israel now proclaim,
his mercy endures forever.
The Lord is my strength and my song.
And he has become my salvation.
There is a sound of exultation and victory
in the tents of the righteous.
The right hand of the Lord has triumphed.
The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord has triumphed.
I shall not die, but live.
And declare the works of the Lord.
The Lord has punished me sorely.
But he did not hand me over to death.
Open for me the gates of righteousness.
I will enter them. I will offer thanks to the Lord.
This is the gate of the Lord.
He who is righteous may enter.
I will give thanks to you, for you answered me.
And have become my salvation.
The same stone which the builders rejected
has become the chief cornerstone.
And this is the Lord's doing.
And it is marvelous in our eyes.
On this day, the Lord has acted.
We will rejoice and be glad in it.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Corinthians. I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which you also stand, through which also you are being saved, if you hold firmly to the message that I proclaimed to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed on to you as of first importance what I in turn had received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. for I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Out of the tomb, and we do not know where they've laid him. Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They've taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they've laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you've laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Easter time. time can mean a lot of different things. At Easter time in the church, we say we remember Christ's death and resurrection. But I say, Easter isn't something we remember. Easter isn't something just for church time. Easter is something we live and breathe. To live as resurrected people, we have to allow this joyful, playful Spirit of God to lead our lives. We have to let this imaginative Spirit be front and center in our lives. We have to give up our insistent claim that we're the center of the universe. This resurrection shouldn't be something we say we believe or just affirm in a creed. It's something we become in the daily living of our lives. It's our transformation from lives of self-centeredness into lives of love and generosity and humility, lives of giving. It's putting God first. It's following Jesus' example of tenderness for one another, of love, not of vengefulness, not of anger. There's so much anger in the world right now. We really need this love, and it has to happen through us. Every day, we're given choice after choice, time after time, to, as we say, repent and turn back to God, to live with love, to live without anger, to live with joy. And each time, we intentionally turn back to God. Each time we make a step in that direction, we are resurrected in Christ. We are reborn in love. Now that can transform the world. But it's up to us to bring God's future kingdom into our present world. It's an intentional act of love. That's what we're celebrating here today. Paul wrote to the Corinthians, the first man was from the earth, a man of dust. The second man is from heaven. Just as we have borne the image of the man of dust, we also bear the image of the man of heaven. Resurrection means joining our mortal lives with the risen Christ. We have been reborn. Easter morning, though it happened in one place, in one time in history, is not restricted to that day. Easter morning is every day for all people. It belongs to all of time. Resurrection is about healing. It's about reconciliation. When we can reconcile ourselves with our brother, when we can reconcile ourselves to our friends, when we can find room in our heart for love and not for anger, this is how we will transform the world. Earth and heaven are joined. The one of dust joins with the one of heaven. Christ's resurrection is a transformation. It's the possibility of the healing of all lives, of all of creation, which is an important thing to think about on this beautiful day when we see all these flowers, this beautiful Earth Day, when we think of this fragile earth, our island home, as the Eucharistic prayer calls it. God's creation is God's gift to us to treat with love. That's what this is all about. It's all about the love. And this will all happen through our transformed, resurrected lives. We proclaim Christ rising on Easter morning. I proclaim Christ rising in our hearts every day, at each decision we make, each time we walk out the door, or send a text message, or meet somebody in the grocery store, The resurrection happens every time you say we're sorry to a friend, or maybe to your mom, or to a brother. Resurrection means healing. It's love in action. In living lives of love and humility, and especially joy, which we have the musicians, how can we not be joyful with all this great music? This is how we transform ourselves. This is the day we celebrate our commitment to resurrection, our baptism into new life, into transformation. And this is indeed a thing to celebrate. It's something to hold tightly to with all your heart. It's the way of love. Hold this day close. Remind yourself 100 times a day, because that's what it'll take. Practice, 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 the old Carnegie Hall thing. We're born to new life. We have died with Christ and been resurrected in love. We won't have to argue the evidence or explain the resurrection to anyone, because our transformed lives will bear witness to the risen Christ. We affirm in our baptismal vows that we'll proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ, that we'll seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving our neighbors as ourselves. This is resurrection life. This is the love of Christ showing through in our lives. Christ rose and set us free from the bondage of sin. And if we believe that, then let's act like it. Let's live in our lives what we believe in our hearts. This is indeed the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Amen.
Amen.
Church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons.
That they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments.
We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
We also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace with you.
Peace with you.
Wedged in there.
You really like that. That's your turn.
By his death, he has destroyed death. And by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you.
victory. Give you joy and peace in your life and faith. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen.